to him.
To him I owe everything. I love those songs that remind us of that, because we sometimes have a tendency of forgetting. At any rate, we are here this morning, and we are together, and yay, the gang is assembling. Miss Terry, first one up this morning. Good girl. Good girl. We love you. Guys, her surgery's coming up here pretty quick, so keep Terry in by. She's got to have a shoulder replacement, or, you know, the rotator cuff and all that, and therapy after that. And then when all that gets settled, they're going to do the leg. So keep Terry in your prayers. Miss Teresa, good morning. It is good to see you there this morning. You were second, Miss, and boy, you guys just came in, put up, put up. So good morning, Miss Sherry, my dear love. Made my coffee this morning and being so nice to me. Mr. Daniel, good to see you there. You be careful at work, my friend. And but it's sure good to have you there. Ryan, good morning to you. Big good morning to Cynthia. Love you. Love you guys. Brent and Brenda, good to see you. Elena, Rick, thank you for lending a hand to Betsy today. Really appreciate that. Debbie says, good morning, everyone. I pray the Lord's love rains down on all of us today. May he fill us with his great love and mercy. He is all we need. Boy, I tell you what, that's a mouthful. And that is absolutely right. And there's Miss Ruth. Yay, Miss Ruth, we love you. And I love those hearts that are up there this morning. God bless. As promised, I didn't get witnessing presentation and how to use John 3 out to you yesterday, but I did send it out this morning. So if you happen to look at your email, it should be there. I sent out everyone that requested, and some that usually request, and you know, I didn't see them. I went ahead and sent it out. So if you didn't get a copy, let me know. If you would, I'd appreciate that. Let me know, and I'll make sure that you do get a copy. Took me a little longer. Sorry, I was going to get it out yesterday, but it took me a little longer to get things typed up and ready to go, and converted and sent. So I got them sent this morning. So you know, I was good to my word. Miss Alyssa, good morning to you, and to Mr. Cameron and Miss Carol. I'm glad she's feeling better. And to Master Cody, it is good to see you. I was just telling everybody, I sent those two witnessing presentations out this morning. So you should have them in your emails this morning. And there is Miss Therese. Good morning to you, my dear friend. It is good to see you. Well, the past 2 days, we've taken kind of one of our famous little detours, a little, you know, cul-de-sac or a little circle drive. You're going down the road, and you take a side road that's going to take you up the mountains and down through a valley and twist around, and then ultimately down you get tied back into the highway that you're traveling. We do those occasionally, but try to stay on plan, try and stay on focus, but sometimes something comes up. Questions are asked. This is your study as well as mine. And when questions are asked, or interest is shown in some way that ties into what we're doing, we're going to take those little detours, because Scripture is given to us, if you remember, for teaching, which we try to do here. Correction, that's between you and God. Reproof, again, but training in righteousness, that's something also we need to do. So that you and I might be completely prepared, equipped for the work that God has given us to do. So we have spent 2 days traveling on a side road and seeing the country, and we're coming back now to the main road. So we're here, but I think it is beneficial, and I think what we did was beneficial by the comments I've gotten now. To put many things that we have looked at so far into a practical and contemporary setting. Because you see, when we come back to Peter's sermon, we're going to see how all of that really does come together. Monday, we used just a gospel presentation. Like I said, you see me Sunday, and I'll make sure you guys get copies of, you know, get tracts. We have several of them at the church. Anytime you want some, all you got to ask. I usually open every, when I'm talking to somebody, I get on a plane and we're flying and I got a guy sitting next to me. I'll ask the question, you know, hey, by the way, I've been doing a lot of study, looking at things. In your opinion, what does it take for a person to go to heaven and have eternal life? I always like that because everybody loves to give their opinion. And that's the one thing that none of us are short on, is opinion. When they get those out, and I tend to agree with them every step of the way, and they say, well, yeah, all that's good, but can I show you what God says? They're either going to say yes or no, and I haven't lost anything to say no. Always has to pray for them. But if they say yes, then I have an opportunity to take them step by step, just like we've shown you. Yesterday, we used John 3, and I've mentioned how I love using John 3. It's one of my favorite places. Sometimes when I find them in bulk, I'll order just little pamphlets that are on John 3. That's all it is, or the Gospel of John. And I would carry those, and I would leave them, give them to the people, and they would have the Gospel of John. But John 3 gives me that witnessing tool. And some of you are curious as to how we do that. Well, now you know. Those first 18 verses are probably the most effective and natural passages anywhere in the Bible that are so condensed that we can use it as a witnessing tool. It's really highly conducive to leading people to Christ, because that one single passage, you know, I've got a marked New Testament, and I can, you know, flip back and forth. If you don't know what a marked New Testament is, that's where you take something like the Roman Road or something like a presentation you like to use, and you mark up your Bible. You have your passage you start, and you know, page one, and there's this passage, and then it refers you to go to page something else in your Bible. You flip there, and there's a two, and there's the second step. You know, God's plan or God's purpose, man's need, God's provision, and man's response. You know, just four steps. Keep those things in mind. You know, God has a plan for your life. And God intended it to be, you know, in living in perfect harmony with Him, but something happened. Something entered in to spoil God's plan. That leaves man with a need. What is man's need? Man's need is for forgiveness. Because sin has come in. We talk about that. But, you know, man is helpless to do anything about his present condition. So, God has a provision. Because He loves you, He has made provision for you. And then you talk about Christ and what Christ has done. You know, death, burial, resurrection, so that you and I could have forgiveness. But we need to respond. So what is man's response? And then you go through those passages. So, you know, it just, if you have a framework, if you have a skeleton in your head of where we need to go, just like writing your testimony or sharing it, three steps, very simply. What was my life like before I came to Christ? How did God bring me to an understanding of my need? What did I do to receive that free gift, and what is my life like since then? I guess that's more. So, you know, it's a very simple step. But if you got that in your mind, and once you set those things in, they're there. And man, you can float in and out of those smoothly, conversationally, which is always the best thing to me, is when you can make it, instead of a presentation, make it a conversation. Make it a dialogue. And they ask questions. You try to get as many questions out up front as you can. But as questions come up, you're able to take that little circle drive, and then you're right back to the presentation, all conversationally. It really is that simple. You see, John 3 is that single passage that I can use without skipping through various chapters and books in the Bible. It's a direct transcription of Jesus' words, his witnessing approach, if you will, to one man, Nicodemus, leading this man to conversationally to pattern his life and to follow Christ. Ryan, I forgot to say I have an unspoken prayer request for my new friend. All right, well, we've got that, Ryan. We will certainly take that up. Thank you. All right. I've shared that when presenting the gospel, there are four foundational things to keep in mind. You say, boy, that's a lot. But it's not difficult. This isn't rocket science. God made it so simple. To exalt the Lord Jesus, we have to deflect any glory, attention away from ourselves and get it onto Christ. Remember? To exalt the Lord Jesus, we must tell people who he is. You see, everybody knows. No, everybody doesn't. I've met an awful lot of people who, born and raised in the United States, have no idea who Jesus is. Oh, they got a bit of information here and there, but they don't know who he is. And to exalt Christ, we must tell people what he's done. That's all this is. And then to exhort the Lord Jesus, we must tell people how they need to respond if they're going to receive this wonderful and free gift. Well, let's pray and get on further, okay? Father, I thought, thank you. Thank you, Lord, that we have the freedom and the ability to come before you every day. And Lord, if we want just to stay in that presence, Lord, it isn't coming back and forth. This is a life lived and sustained in the presence of God. You dwell in us. We walk in fellowship and communion with you. I think if you're going into the garden and walking with Adam and walking with Eve and in that perfect environment, but yet, Lord, you come in this very imperfect environment to dwell in me, that we may walk and talk. So, Father, we take the opportunity to lift up Ryan's friend. I don't know what the unspoken is, but God, you know. So we lift him up to you, thanking you, Lord, that you hear our prayer. I thank you for each of these people, Lord, and the hunger that they have to know you. And I believe, Lord, there's equally a hunger within them to share you effectively. God, I think I've seen that this week. As we have talked about sharing our faith and sharing the hope that we have in you. So, Father, I just simply ask you to continue to teach us. Give us those aha with as we build step by step on this skeleton, on this framework. Say, oh, aha, I recognize that. And, Lord, just make us to see with eyes that are clear. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. It's good to have Ruth back with us. It's good that all of that stuff is kind of left. And Ruth is back with us. And Mardell, God bless you. It is good to have you with us. It really is. If you would like to be added to our email list, and I can send you stuff that, you know, from time to time, I'll have, like, these presentations that I did, and people want copies or something like that, and I send them out to them, just let me know, and I would love to do that. But it is good to have you among us. Everybody say hi to Mardell. All right. Let's get back to our text in Acts 3. All right. Are you ready? And all the people saw that he was walking. This is a man that was healed, the lame man at the gate, you know, beautiful. And he was walking and praising God. And they were taking note of him as being as one who was used to sit at the beautiful gate of the temple to beg alms. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. And while he was clinging to Peter and John, all the people ran together at the so-called Portico of Solomon, full of amazement. But Peter saw this, and he replied to the people, "Men of Israel, why are you amazed at this? Why do you gaze at us as if by our own power and piety we made him walk?" Now, attention off of us, attention on to Jesus. The God of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, the God of your fathers, he's glorified his servant, Jesus, the one whom you delivered and disowned in the presence of Pilate when he had decided to release him. But you disowned the holy and righteous one and asked for a murderer to be granted to you, but put to death the Prince of Peace, the one whom God raised from the dead, a fact to which we all are witnesses. Tell people what he's done. And on the basis of faith in his name, it is the name of Jesus which has strengthened this man whom you see and know. And faith which comes through him has been given to him this perfect health in the presence of all of you. All right. We've gotten that far. There's more of the message to go. And it even overflows into chapter 4. Now, there's an interruption, an interlude. We have an intermission because temple police come and arrest them and drag them away. So they got to finish the sermon the next day, but he gets it all out. So we've looked at several of the identifiers, have we not, that Peter uses to bring their attention to who Jesus is and what Jesus has done. He calls him the servant of Jesus, or his servant Jesus, you know, relating to him the fact that you know, Jesus is God who has come to serve and not to be served, to give his life, if you will, a ransom for many. He is the holy and righteous one. He's sinless. He was the sinless Lamb of God who did not think it was robbery to be equal with God, but he emptied himself, set his divinity aside, his power, his omniscience, all that, put it on a shelf, refused to act upon it, and came into the form of a man. He came in the form of a bondservant. He was obedient to the Father, even unto death, which was the death of the cross. But then he calls him the Prince of Life. For in him we find life, right? Jesus says, nobody can take my life. I lay it down. And God's given me the power to take it back up again. You know, so life emanates. God is the very source of life. So Jesus, when he said this, was equating himself to God. So Peter's making these same claims about Christ that he made of himself. And then he calls him God's Christ. Uh-oh. Then we really get into it. Because the word they use, the Christos, in the Greek, simply means the Messiah in Hebrew. He is the anointed one, the appointed one. He is God's sent one. He is the Son of Man. He is the Son of God. He is all of these prophetic titles given to him, pointing to the one that would come to redeem his people. Now, Peter refers to Jesus as God's Christ, who appointed him. He says, "And now, brethren, I know that you acted in ignorance, just as your rulers did also. But the things which God announced beforehand by the mouth of his prophets, that his Christ, his Messiah, his Messiah, would suffer, he is thus fulfilled. Everything that Isaiah 53 says about him, he fulfilled. Therefore, you need to tell men what they need to do in response to who Jesus is and what he's done. Repent and return so that your sins may be wiped away, in order that times of refreshment may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send Jesus the Christ appointed to you. Now, because he's the Christ, he's the Messiah, he said, you need to forsake your sin. You need to turn from sin and self and follow after him. If our life is ever to be refreshed and made new, we have to come back to him. Remember that faith across it? Forsaking all, I trust him. That's what Peter's talking about. And this is how the layman was refreshed and made new. And this is how our life is refreshed and made new. In verses 19 through 21, he said, therefore repent and return, so that your sins may be wiped away. That means to be taken completely away, in order that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send Jesus the Christ appointed for you, whom heaven must receive until the period of restoration of all things, about which God spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets in ancient times. Well, then as he moves on, there's another title that he gives him, and that is a prophet like Moses. Peter's going to show that Jesus is also the prophet whom Moses predicted. And he uses Deuteronomy 18:15 in order to do that. The words of Moses, verses 22 through 24. Moses said, the Lord God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your brethren. To him you shall give heed to everything he says to you. And it shall be that every soul that does not heed the prophet shall be utterly destroyed from among the people. There's a penalty for rejecting Christ. And likewise, all the prophets who have spoken from Samuel and his successors onward also announced these days. Repent, return. Receive Christ Messiah for the forgiveness of your sins, and if you do not, there will be a penalty. God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Those who believe, they're saved, but those who do not believe, they're already under condemnation. John 3:17-18. See how things fit. Go back to what we've done for 2 days and see this pattern in what Peter is doing. Now, while Samuel himself made no recorded prophecy about Messiah, he did something very graphically to point to it. He did appoint and anoint David as king, and spoke of his kingdom through his descendants that would be eternal, which was fulfilled in Jesus. Just like that, Moses says, God will raise up a prophet like me from among the people. Jesus came up from among the people. He didn't come from the ruling class. He didn't come from the the hallowed priestly halls. No, he came up from a dusty little town called Nazareth, born in a stable in Bethlehem, raised in a carpenter's shop in Nazareth. So much so, his brothers didn't believe any of this until after his crucifixion and resurrection. Remember now, again, we need to come back and remember context. I know. You're going to say, there it is again. He's going to do it again. He's going to do it again. You're right. Context, context, context. Patricia, hello to you. It is good to see you. I give you a wave as well. Everybody say hi to Patricia. All right. Remember, Peter is preaching to the Jews here. He's telling them that Jesus died and rose again and ascended into heaven and initiated this age of grace during which sins can be forgiven and seasons of refreshing can come. And in the future, the Messiah will return and he will establish his millennial kingdom on earth, which was a constant subject of interest to Jewish prophets throughout the Old Testament. That's what he's talking about here. And then, the coup de grace, if you will, he calls him Abraham's seed. You see, Jesus is the seed of Abraham, through whom all the nations of the earth shall be blessed. And then he concludes by stating again that Jesus is God's servant whom he raised up. In the sense of 3:22, a prophet, that's what he's talking about. He's not talking about in reference to the resurrection. Context again. Raised him up as a prophet and sent him to bless them by turning them from their wicked ways back to God. Take a look at Acts 3:25-26. It is you who are the sons of the prophets and of the covenant which God made with your father, saying to Abraham, and in your seed all the families of the earth will be blessed. For you first, God raised up his servant and sent him to bless you. So see context, he's talking about not the resurrection, but he raised him up as a prophet, sent him to bless you by turning every one of you from your wicked ways. He came to love you. He came to turn you from your wicked ways. You know, he did no wrong, in other words. He was crucified unjustly. But it was God's plan, as he said in his first sermon, from the very beginning, in order to redeem and cover the very sins of the people of God if they would turn to him. So Peter, in relating to his Jewish audience, has shown Jesus to be in the line of God's promises to Abraham, to Moses, and to David. So there's another great name for Jesus, Abraham's seed, or Abraham's offspring. Paul does very much the same thing, does he not? When answering the question of who or what is Abraham's seed, when he writes to the churches in Galatia, one of my favorite passages of scripture I love to use with folks. Verses 15 through 16 in chapter 3 of Galatians. Brethren, I speak of human relations. In other words, I'm going to give you an illustration. A human illustration that you can all grab hold of. Even though it's a man's covenant, yet when it has been ratified, no one sets it aside or adds conditions to it. In other words, you enter into a covenant, you enter into a contract with somebody, and you ratify that contract, it's set. All right? you can't come up to the you're building a house and you contract with a builder to build your house. The plans are laid out. He's looked at the blueprints. He's done all the measurements and the calculations. He says it's going to take this much to build your house. You look at it and you say, okay, I agree to that. You shake hands, you sign the contract, and you're bound to it. He's going to build, you're going to pay. All agree. Now, you can't come up to him and say, later on down the road, listen, I want to add a room, you know, over here on this side. I want to change this. But you expect it to be at the same price that you've signed for. You can't do that. You can't change or alter. Okay? And he can't come up and say, listen, I missed this room over here, so I need to add this. No, it's set. That's what he's talking about. Now, I know we have legal ways now of wangling our way around that, but context again, not in that day. Then he says this. Now, the promises were spoken to Abraham and to his seed. He does not say as to seeds, as in referring to many, but rather to one. And to his seed, and that is Christ. All right. Now, Wednesday night, we've been looking at the covenants, right? And we've done them in these studies here. Remember, as we discussed and talked about Abraham's covenant with God? Remember the ceremony that sealed that covenant? The cutting ceremony, where they took, you know, animals, they cut them in half and laid the slaughtered halves on either side of this pathway, and the birds and all of that. And then the two people making the covenant were to walk through that gooey-ooty mess as they ratified the contract. What that says when they did that was that if either one of us break the covenant, we will forfeit our life like these animals have forfeited theirs. But you remember in Abraham's covenant, who walked in the midst of the sacrifice? Abraham did not. You had a smoking pot and a fiery torch that walked through. There were fire. We went through all of this here Wednesday night. So, and I've gone it with you guys, you know, a couple of times. But what you have to take notice of is Abraham did nothing in ratifying that covenant. God did it all. Our relationship with God is based on what God has done for us. Not what we can do for God. I wish I had a dollar for every time somebody has come up to me and said, oh, Pastor, I let God down this week. How many of you have ever felt like that? And you know, some of you, you've heard this, you know it's coming. My loving statement is, whoever told you you were propping God up? Let God down. God holds us up. We may let ourselves down, but we can't let God down. No. Was Abraham able to keep the covenant? No, he broke it almost as quick as it was made. But who... Let's go back to that human illustration again. You're building a house. And the builder says, you know, it's going to take, you know, $500,000 to build this house. And you say, I don't have $500,000. So you go out to somebody, you know, think of some rich person's, you know, you go out to Bill Gates, And Billy Boy decides, okay, you know, yeah, I'll back you. I'll co-sign that note for you. Now you've entered into that contract with the builder, party the first part, and then you and Bill Gates co-parties to the second part. Builds a house, he comes to you and he says, pay me $500,000. And you say, I don't got it. Is he going to mess with you again? No, he's going to go knocking on Bill Gates' door and say, okay, you owe me $500,000. Because he makes good on your debt. God made good on my debt. What the law could not do, because of my sinful flesh, God did, by sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh to condemn sin in the flesh. He kept the law for me. He paid the debt for me. He carried the burden of my sin. He took my sin away. He buried my sin as far as the east is from the west, in the deepest part of the sea. He covered my sin and forgot it forever. God did that. Abraham's seed did that. Every promise, every assurance is guaranteed to us in Abraham's seed, in God's Christ, in the Messiah. And he stands behind every promise because only he can perfectly keep the covenant. That's why every promise that God has made is yes and yes. The very first paragraph of the book of Acts, Luke tells us that Jesus showed himself alive with many infallible proofs. And throughout the book of Acts, we have miracles done in the name of Christ, including changed lives. And here, Peter is appealing to fulfill the messianic scripture. And when you are sharing the gospel with people, people will try to get you going down every kind of rabbit trail, which I say is okay. If they want to try and lead you down there, you know, just know how you're going to get back. Sometimes you need to answer their questions. But always keep in mind the central fact that the person needs to see who Jesus is. And the book of Acts is filled with evidential apologetics. The first church didn't believe in Christ despite the evidence. They believed because of the evidence. Can you see that? Thank you for Patricia. You bless my heart. I appreciate that. And I pray I can live up to that. Do you see this? The early church didn't believe in Jesus. They didn't follow him through all the persecution and everything, despite the evidence. As if there were no evidence to substantiate. No, they believed because of the evidence that was presented. And we'll start there tomorrow and pick up as we finish this section and probably get moved on into chapter 24. All right. Pray for one another. Lift one another up. Bless one another. Find somebody that you can bless today, will you? Say, God, make me a blessing to somebody. You may not be able to get out, but I bet you got a phone. You can drop a note. You can pick up a phone. Be a blessing to someone today. Do some random act of kindness. And when they say, why are you doing this? Say, because you're special and God loves you. be surprised where some of those conversations can take you. May God bless. I'll see you tomorrow, right here, same time, same station. God bless. Father, thank you so very much for the love that I can share with these people, and they give to me every single day. May you be glorified in us, and may we fill the space in which we live with the knowledge of your glory. Thank you, Lord. See y'all later.